Hey everyone, welcome back to Mechanical Pros. Today we're going to be shooting a video on how to properly wire low water cutoff controls for basin heaters on cooling towers. Fortunate enough to have our man with us today, our technical expert, Mr. Jeff Smith, and we're going to talk about the low water cutoff and the thermostat. I want to show a couple little components that go along with this and quick overview of what they are. This would be our mechanical fill valve in our cooling tower. So as this plunger drops, it drops water out of the valve. The valve opens as the plunger raises, just like on your tool at home, shuts a water spout. Simple enough. So we're gonna set that, adjust it, and it's gonna hit a certain level in the tower, and it's gonna maintain that water level. And then we're gonna use a basin heater in the bottom of our cooling tower sump. This is gonna keep our cooling tower basin from freezing. And Jeff is gonna talk about these two devices that directly relate to this basin heater, turn it on and off, and also protect us from it coming on when there's no water in the tower.
Correct. Cooling tower basins will freeze. And the reason why we do basin heater control is if you've ever been involved in a basin that has frozen, that's on a rooftop, what ends up happening, the plunger that Brian showed a minute ago could get frozen in the down position. It will continue to dump water, and you could overfill the basin if it's frozen, fill a rooftop up with 1 to 3 inches of ice at about 100 pounds per square foot. And so you put that on top of a rooftop, becomes very dangerous. So what we're going to talk about today is the proper way, and it's probably one of the least understood methods.
Yes.
It's very critical, but for some reason, most of my calls and field calls are generally on how to wire the components that allow the basin heater to come on. Like Brian said, this is inserted into the basin, and it's based on how big the tower basin is, how many kilowatts of heat that we put into it. This control is a three-phase device, and so we have to control the three-phase contactor, and I'll go over here in a little bit in a ladder diagram.
Yeah.
That'll show you, how to connect it. But mm-hmm. I want to talk about the devices themselves. This device will plug into the tower, and what this is what we call a low water cutoff. If there's no water in the tower, we do not want the heater to come on because an unsubmerged heater will fail. It'll get so hot because there's no water around it to cool it. It'll get so hot that it'll fail. So we don't want that heater to come on if there's no water in the tower. It's done with this device right here, which is a low water cutoff. Low water cutoff, it goes into the basin. If the water is too low, that little float drops out. It opens up the contact. If it is full of water, that float comes up and closes the contact and allows us to go ahead and control. The second device that we use is based on temperature. We use a thermostat. This device right here is a temperature sensor. It goes into a thermal well that's on the basin, mm-hmm. plugs right in there, and it feeds back water temperature. Now, there's some hysteresis in this. This is not an instrumentation device.
Right, yep.
So we're gonna have we could have anywhere from a 8 to 10 degree swing on when it actuates. But basically what it is once that goes in there, in our wiring diagram that I'm gonna show you here in a second, our service techs will go ahead, they'll mount this on the tower, it's wired in with the level control, and then what they do is, if you'll notice on here, there's a dial. This dial is in temperature, and as you turn this dial is when it turns on and turns off. As you get down to the 50 to 60 degree range, this room is probably 50 degrees, the contact opens and closes, okay? This right here is your basic control. This will control the heater during normal conditions and a full basin. So this this device right here is probably one of the most important that it actuates correctly. Yep.
So Jeff, what you're saying is this little sensor then is sensing the temperature of the water in that sump of the cooling tower, that basin. And you're adjusting this dial, and it makes or breaks, which in turn ends up energizing the heater to keep our tower from freezing, basically.
Right. What we want to do is we want to set this dial to above freezing. We never want to get to freezing. So generally, we set these at about 40, 45 degrees, somewhere in there. And it'll go ahead and turn on and turn off.
You wouldn't want it running all the time. You're wasting energy and all that.
So you waste energy.
Keep it from freezing.
Right, just to keep it from freezing. Gotcha. So that's why we go ahead. This contact block right here, mm-hmm. that contact block is what I'm going to show you here in a drawing. That's what actually completes the circuit and breaks the circuit.
That's great, because those three terminals do cause some confusion.
They do.
Speaking from experience yeah. there.
So if I can just explain to you a little bit, a lot of people like to use the center post mm-hmm. as the common. That is not the mm-hmm. common. This post over here that is separated a little bit is my common. Yeah. And remember, it's Form C. So that means you have a common, a normally open, and a normally closed.
Right, gotcha.
So the way that it's wired is it always goes left to right, all right?
Okay.
So your common,
yeah.
normally yeah. closed, normally open.
Yep.
We wire to the normally open because we want that to close on temperature.
Yeah.
Okay.
So guys out in the field, when I see red, blue, yellow, that usually means something totally different to me.
Yes.
So this is an important one.
It's
sure.
an important because yeah. everybody wants to use that middle post.
You got it.
And
yep.
so what it is the two outside posts whenever you're dealing with basin
gotcha.
Heaters.
Gotcha.
Because this device can be used in other pieces of equipment where you want to turn
right.
it on in
sure.
high temperature.
Sure, yeah.
So you would wire across the normally closed.
Gotcha. Yep.
Okay?
Got it.
And then this, one thing I wanted to show you is I also wanted to get back to this. When these come from the factory, they have little stay-cons that are on here that show you where you're supposed to land the wire, but there is also a wiring diagram on the inside. So what I want to do right now, Brian, is I want to kind of walk us through what we send out with our techs as
okay.
far as a wiring diagram.
Yeah, yeah, great.
This is ladder logic, but what this drawing actually does is it'll show you all of these components in electrical schematic.
Okay.
So the first thing that I want to point out is I want to point out the basin heater circuit itself. This is an overview that shows all of the three phase for the basin heater, and it also shows the control circuit.
Okay, so we're high voltage and low voltage
high
on this wiring diagram. Gotcha.
Correct, high
okay.
voltage and low voltage. So we have 480 volt that comes in through a circuit breaker, and then it comes down and it hits our primary protection for our heater circuit. Now, we didn't show any of that, but basically all it is it's a branch circuit protector, like a circuit breaker,
okay.
and then a contactor on the inside. Now, the contactor is gonna be represented in our control diagram that I'm gonna show you here in
mm-hmm.
a second. I'll show you the coil, but really all it does is it makes and breaks the three phase going to the heater.
Okay.
Okay, so what I wanna show you is I wanna show you the representation in the electrical diagram of the basin heater.
Okay.
This device right here, now this is an 18 kW basin heater, and it shows 37.5 amps. So
mm-hmm.
all of our other devices will be sized large enough to handle that much current. But in the drawing itself is when you look at this device right here, this device physically is this device here, our basin heater that is actually in the bottom of the basin.
Okay.
Okay.
Gotcha. So it's submerged up to this point, is in the water, and this is outside the tower.
Correct.
Okay.
Electrical connections are inside this screw top, and this right here goes in, and you know it's got a threaded nipple on there, and
right.
it threads right in there, and it sits in
gotcha.
The bottom of the basin. Okay. So if we move on from that and we get into the control circuit, and this is the part that lends itself to a little bit of confusion, even to our most seasoned techs.
Very confusing. It shouldn't be, but it is. It
right.
is a confusing wiring diagram.
Right, sure. because when you get the devices and the devices are in front of you,
mm-hmm.
you can read the diagram, you understand the function, but putting two and two together sometimes doesn't always go together.
Agreed.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to zoom in on our control circuit. And if you'll notice, remember you were talking about you have high and low voltage. So what
yeah.
we do is we mount a control circuit transformer.
Okay.
And we take our 480 volt and we knock it down to 120 volt. All of the control circuits that are on both my level control and on my contactor inside are 120
volt. Not 24 volt, but 120, okay.
Correct.
Gotcha.
Because we never know how far we're going to be away from the source, and so 120 travels farther than 24 will.
I see.
24
okay.
will stop operating at 19 volts,
right.
and it's 10 volts per 100. And so if we get a long ways away,
gotcha.
I'm going to be
got 150 foot of wire, it's probably not going to.
Right.
Gotcha.
So
okay.
I can operate at 105 volts in 120 volt circuits. I can't operate at 14 volts, 24 volt circuit.
Got it. Good information.
So what I want to do is, like I said, we have the control circuit transformer, and then we're going to go ahead and we're going to talk about this circuit right here. Okay. This circuit right here is, like I said, this is what lends itself to a bunch of confusion. And so we need to go ahead and explain each component,
mm-hmm.
and then I'll explain the entire function of how it actually works.
Okay.
Okay. So the first thing that we have is you'll notice here you have a heater on switch. Now that is normally mounted on the front of the basin heater control panel, and there's always going to be a pilot light so that you know when it's on. Okay. And
like
I'll show you
on off switch, light up green on
right.
or something.
Because in the summertime we may just want to kill that circuit completely so it doesn't inadvertently come on. There's no reason for it. So service tech or anybody, they can go up there,
right.
they can isolate this. This isolates the control. It's not a lockout tagout point, but it is a way for you to control the control circuit. So it's on and off.
Okay.
Okay. So once we switch the switch over to on, if you'll notice here, we have a pump interlock as well. Normally, there's a jumper at this point
mm-hmm.
because unless it's a closed circuit cooler, we don't have pumps.
Right.
You know,
so a water source heat pump loop, you got a pump at the tower, you're not always going to have that.
You're not always going to have it. But what we do is we try to accommodate it because we have
yeah.
one way to build it.
Right.
I don't want to confuse anybody anymore. Yeah. So we go ahead and build them this way and we just put a jumper in that circuit. If the circuit exists, remove the jumper
right.
and put your two wires.
So not going to do a loop pump. That's only for a pump mounted on the cooling tower.
That's it.
Gotcha.
Only for a pump mounted on the cooling tower. Okay, so the next device that we're going to look at is the thermostat. Now, this is the device that we want to rely on it turning the heater on and off because
mm-hmm.
it's sensing the water temperature. And so it's what's going to be your main control for turning on, turning off. Okay, and so these two points that you see here that we explained a minute ago, these are my two contact points, my form C. Here's your common, here's your normally open. If you refer back to the drawing, here's my common, here's my normally open. Okay?
Gotcha.
So that contact closes. Once that contact closes, if you'll notice, everything that you see in the dotted block, that is our level control.
That's that guy there.
That's
okay.
this device right here. Okay? So referring back to the drawing again, everything that we saw in the dotted box is this device right here. I want to explain this device a little bit. All it really is, Brian, is an ice cube relay mounted in this enclosure.
Mm-hmm.
So it comes from the factory with connectors on it. So you know where you're supposed to wire.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But for some reason, these get pulled off or whatever.
Yeah,
but
that's got me, Jeff, before. I have just come across, full disclosure.
Yeah.
I just want to make break. And I've just wired across the terminal that when it closes, okay, I'm sending my voltage back out. That is not the way to wire that switch.
That is not the way to wire that switch. You never want to embed 120 yeah. volt into a water environment.
Yes, this is a very important part.
Very important. So what we're doing is we're isolating that 120 volt. So when you look at this relay, again, it's a Form C relay. And on this one here, you have a total of 8 prongs on the bottom of the relay, okay? The two that run that are pointed in the direction of the relay, that's your coil.
Okay.
The three that are close together, those are your relay contacts, okay? So on this particular relay, what we're using is we're using a normally open contact. So if you'll notice on the relay itself, they're split apart and the common is always farther away from your other two contact points. So this is your common. That's the reason why we have a connector on that one on the
okay.
relay we're using.
Yep.
Now we're going to be using the normally open, and the way that relays work, center post is always open.
Okay.
Farthest away is always closed, just like what we had on the thermostat.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
So what we're doing is we're going to go ahead and these two points right here is our relay contact, and our other point is the other side of our coil.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that explains to you what we're doing on the relay.
Yeah.
Okay. So now let's take a look at it in the drawing form. So if everything in the dotted box is our level control, this right here is the relay that we just explained. And if you'll notice,
yep.
I already have them numbered. And there are numbers on that relay. You just have to look real close.
Right.
But 3 and 5 is our relay contact points. Okay.
Okay.
And then we have 7 and 8 are our coil contacts. So basically what happens is if water temperature is low,
mm-hmm.
this relay on the thermostat is going to close. As long as I have water in the basin, this relay here will be closed.
Meaning our float is up.
Our float is up.
Gotcha.
Okay. And the reason it's going to be up is if you'll notice also too, is that we bring a constant source of 120 to the relay.
Okay.
We do not introduce it into the water environment.
Energizing your coil on your relay, but not across your switch.
Right. So what we do on the relay, what they do for us is they go ahead and they bring out this wire here that's numbered 15.
Okay.
This is where we would go ahead and wire nut, of which you know I'm not a big fan of wire nuts.
I love wire nuts.
But in control circuits, they're absolutely,
they're okay.
So what we do is we land the neutral at wire number 15, and then the other side of the relay, it actually comes back, and that connection is already made for you at the factory.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Now you're going to ask me, okay, you know, why did we break the neutral? Okay. Just for the same thing that we were just talking about.
Yeah.
I'm going to break the neutral because it will still kill the coil on that relay. Opening up CR1 relay, because this is basically CR1. If you'll notice, the coil is labeled CR1.
Okay. Yep.
Okay. And then the relay contact is CR1. So as we energize that, if there's water in there, mm-hmm. that relay is going to be energized all the time. It is fired up and powered up.
All the time.
All the time that okay. water's in there. And then that relay will be closed. And then if the thermostat closes, it comes back out. And remember the heater contactor that I was going to tell mm-hmm. you that we were, it's actually in the panel with its own branch circuit protection.
Yep.
This is representative of the coil on the heater contactor. So when I supply power to that coil, it goes ahead and closes the contactor, allows the three phase to pass through to our basin heater, and it begins to heat up
yep,
our water.
Gotcha. Now, Jeff, is it very critical to make sure that that device is mounted in the proper orientation on the cooling tower?
Absolutely. What we've found is if they're not mounted in the proper orientation,
mm-hmm.
what happens is it puts enough friction on this that it won't operate freely.
So if it's tilted a little or
if
something?
If it's tilted a little bit. So if you'll notice over here on the side, it says this side up. It's not only this side up, it needs to be absolutely perpendicular. This needs to be pointing straight down, Brian.
Yeah.
If it's not, if it is pointing this way, if it is pointing this way, it inhibits the actuation.
It can hang up or maybe it, not close or open
or maybe
as it
not
should.
Close. So this okay. making sure that this connection to the basin is tight
yeah.
and vertical. If it's
yeah.
not vertical, yeah, it's not going to be consistent.
Yeah, because it's plastic, so they can only tighten it so much. So you could probably just bump it and it might turn
just a little
possibly
bit. Yeah, or hang in a certain spot.
Yeah, right.
And not actuate the relay.
So you can walk by and just see the arrow and know, okay, this thing's straight
yeah.
up and down.
Yeah, one of the things that I do is I look at the arrow and then I look at the conduit connection. If I'm
okay.
not absolutely straight up and down on my conduit connection, if there's a little bend.
Right, right. If it's tugging on it or something.
That's going to be the first thing that I'm going to have somebody fix.
Gotcha. Excellent.
We want to try to give everybody a full picture of how basin heater control works.
Yeah.
Because it's really probably one of the most important pieces of equipment on the cooling tower, and it seems like it should be really simple
yeah.
to put together.
Most important, most commonly missed, I would
yeah.
say.
Yeah. And most commonly, it's the one that generally doesn't function right, and it's always, always a wiring issue.
Yep. That's mm-hmm. great stuff, Jeff. Thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
You guys be sure to subscribe and like our channel. If you got any comments or any questions about any other videos, shoot them out there for us, and we'll be sure to get back to you.